Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture series 6 on excretory physiology. So in the last class we had discussed about the tubular reabsorption and secretion, the basic processes that are involved. So in today's class we are discussing about the counter current mechanism. The peculiar thing that could be seen in the kidney is that whenever we go from the cortex deep inside the medulla, the osmolarity of the interstitial fluid keeps on increasing. That means to say, in the cortex, if you find the osmolarity of 300 milliosmoles, when you go deep inside the medulla, it can range anywhere from 1200 to 2800, or it may be 3000 milliosmoles. That is, we have an increased hyperosmolar medullary interstitium in the kidney. Now the question is that why this maintenance of this concentration gradient is most important? Why there should be an increased, or this osmolar gradient maintenance is important inside the kidney? This is very much essential for the concentration of the urine. So the concentration of the urine occurs through the mechanism of counter current mechanism. What do you mean by it? The reabsorption of the water. Reabsorption of water is made possible by this counter current mechanism. That is, for example, you think you do have the renal tubule. For example, if every part of the renal tubule or every segment of the renal tubule has got the same osmolarity, for example, it is 300 everywhere, which is similar to that of the plasma, even in the interstitium it is the same. Think, for example, now if you are dehydrated, or if the plasma osmolarity increases inside the body, if the plasma osmolarity increases, or if you are dehydrated, then it is most important for the reabsorption of the water. As we know, the water will move by the osmosis process towards, because of the difference in the osmolarity, towards the area of higher osmolarity. So if the osmolarity is same in every segment, there is no question of movement of water. So this maintenance is most important for the reabsorption of the water, which plays a very important during the dehydration processes, and by which a decreased amount of fluid can be seen in the urine with high osmolarity. So if the urine output decreases, the water is reabsorbed and it goes back to the plasma, and it maintains the plasma osmolarity by increasing the volume inside the plasma. So this is the most importance of the counter current mechanism. We'll see in detail. How it is made possible is the next question. It is made, or how it is done? It is done by the anatomical and physiological arrangements of the structures in a nephron. There are few areas in a nephron which influences this mechanism, so that the medullary osmolarity can be maintained. For example, what does counter current mechanism in general mean? So this refers to are the basic essential thing for the counter current mechanism is there should be two tubes running close to each other, and the movement of the fluid in these tubes should be in opposite direction. So there should be tube 1 and tube 2 with close proximity, and the movement of the fluid should be in a two different direction. This is the basic essentiality for counter current mechanism. Where you can see this in a nephron? You can see this in a nephron in loop of Henle. So in a loop of Henle, we do have a descending limb and also we do have an ascending limb. So it is a two tubes, one is the descending limb of Henle and the ascending limb of Henle, and the movement of the fluid is also opposite. In the descending limb of Henle, the fluid from the proximal convoluted tubule passes down, and in the ascending loop of Henle, the fluid moves up towards the distal convoluted tubule. So the movement of the fluid is opposite. There are two tubes close to each other, therefore this is one of the sites where the countercurrent mechanism can be seen. The second site in which this countercurrent mechanism can be seen is in the vasa recta. Why in vasa recta? Again, vasa recta, we have already stated, these are the straight vessels. So vasa recta mean these are straight. They go down towards the loop of Henle, and if you see, you have descending vasa recta and ascending vasa recta. In the descending vasa recta, the blood comes down, and in the ascending vasa recta, the blood goes up. So again, these are the two tubes close to each other. The movement of the fluid is opposite. So the countercurrent mechanism inside a nephron can be seen due to the anatomical arrangements of descending loop of Henle, ascending loop of Henle, descending vasa recta and ascending vasa recta. Now, inside the kidney, the loop of Henle will establish or it will create so the loop of Henle establishes or creates this osmolarity or increased osmolarity in the medulla is created by loop of Henle, whereas the vasa recta maintains it. So the maintenance of this medullary hyperosmolarity is done by the vasa recta, whereas the loop of Henle establishes or creates this increased osmolarity. The mechanism in specific that is occurring in loop of Henle is called counter current multiplier, because there is a vertical multiplication in the osmolarity of the fluids. So it keeps on multiplying. That is the reason it is called counter current multiplier. Whereas the mechanism that is occurring in vasa recta is called counter current exchanger. It is called as exchanger because there is no change. It just helps in the exchange of few of the materials. Therefore, it helps in the maintenance of the osmolarity, whatever that has been created by loop of Henle. Therefore, it is an active process of the countercurrent multiplication, whereas the countercurrent exchanger is a passive process. So now we'll see how the countercurrent multiplier system works. So this is a segment of loop of Henle where you have the descending limb here and the ascending limb. So the loop of Henle gets the fluid from the proximal convoluted tubule, and the proximal convoluted tubule, the tubular fluid is isotonic. That means it is similar to that of the plasma osmolarity, therefore it is 300 milliosmoles. So the fluid that is entering inside the descending limb has got 300 milliosmoles of the osmolarity. So always you have here it is 300, 300, 300, 300. This is the first situation, situation number one. That is, by the previous explanations we know, the descending limb is the one which is permeable to water. So you do have aquaporins type 1 through which the water can move inside the interstitial fluid. So this is the interstitial fluid. Whereas the ascending limb is impermeable to water, however they are permeable to solute. And we have seen the most important transporter that is present in the ascending limb is sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter in the previous lecture video. So we'll see what happens in the second step. So this is the first step where the osmolarity is similar in all the segments of the tubule. Now second, so you do have a tubule. So what happens here, when the fluid reaches the ascending limb, in the ascending limb there is movement of sodium, potassium and also the chloride, 2 chloride into the interstitial space through sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter. So whenever the solute are made to pass through the interstitium, what happens to the osmolarity here? It decreases. It was 300. As there was movement of the potassium, sodium and 2 chloride, think it has decreased to 200. So we do have 200, 200, 200 here. Why it became from 300 to 200 milliosmoles? Because of the movement of sodium, potassium and 2 chloride. The solutes are moving out to the interstitial space. Therefore, we had a decreased osmolarity here in the ascending limb. So what happened to the osmolarity in the interstitial space? So here the interstitial space also had the same osmolarity of 300. Why? In every segment it is 300. So there is equal movement of solute in the water. So it is maintained at 300 milliosmoles. In the second, there was movement of sodium, potassium and 2 chloride from the ascending limb through sodium, potassium, 2 chloride symporter. So the osmolarity inside the ascending limb decreased. It was added to the interstitial fluid, so it became, instead of 300, it became 400. So why it is 400? Because of the addition of these three. Therefore, you can see the interstitial osmolarity increased. Now, in the third important step, the same thing. We had 200 milliosmoles here because of the movement. There was 400 here because of the movement of sodium, potassium and 2 chloride. So what will happen in the descending limb fluid? We have stated it has got aquaporin 1 through which the water flows. So whatever the water that is present here passes to main, so the water will move towards the increased osmolarity. So what was the initial osmolarity here in the descending limb? It was 300. So as the water moves out, the osmolarity increases. It becomes again compensated, or it gets equilibrated towards the interstitial fluid and becomes 400. So here you have 400 milliosmoles in the descending limb, 400, this is an example, it is not exact, so it is an example that is taken for the easy explanation. So we do have 400 milliosmoles in the interstitium and 200 milliosmoles in the ascending limb. How it was made possible? By the movement of potassium, 2-chloride and sodium from the in the ascending limb through the transporter. So by the composition movement of the water through the descending limb. So by this mechanism, there is an increased osmolarity in the medulla. So this is called single flow effect. Single flow effect. What is single flow effect? The increased osmolarity of the medulla that is made possible because of the movement of solutes through the ascending limb and the movement of the water to maintain the equilibration. Now, in the fourth step, we will see the fourth step. Again, we do have the same loop of Henle. So, what we had here, we had 200, 400, 400 as an example. Now, in the next step, there is a fluid flow. So, what do you mean by fluid flow? There is a fresh fluid that is coming from proximal convoluted tubule. So there is glomerular filtration that is going on as a normal process. The plasma is filtered, it goes to the PCT. In the PCT there is reabsorption and secretion, and next the fluid has to move through the descending limb. So the fresh fluid from the PCT enters. What is the osmolality of the fresh fluid? It is 300 milliosmoles. So the fresh fluid is having 300 milliosmoles. Initially, what was the osmolality of the fluid that was present in the descending limb? It was 400. So it is pushed upwards. So you do have 400, 400, 400 that is pushed. So what was the osmolality of the fluid in the ascending limb previously? For example, it was 200, so it is pushed upward again towards the distal convoluted tubule. So whenever the fresh fluid passes on, the fluids are pushed to the next segment. Now what happens in the next step? You get more and more of hyperosmolar solution, therefore more and more of solute can go off. So in the next step again, it is 400. So whenever the solute moves in, it becomes 500, 500. Why it becomes 500? It is an addition. It was before 400. So it becomes 500. 500 because of addition of more and more of sodium, potassium and chloride. Understood the concept here? Again to repeat. Whenever there is an initial flow, everywhere it is maintained as 300 milliosmoles in the descending limb, ascending limb and also in the interstitial fluid. Whenever there is in the ascending limb, because of the movement of sodium, potassium and 2-chloride into the interstitium, inside the interstitium the osmolarity increases. Inside the interstitium. Whereas inside the ascending limb it decreases. So there will be movement of the water, therefore the fluid present in the descending limb also gets hyperosmolar. So whenever a fresh fluid flows, you do get an increased hyperosmolar solution towards the ascending limb. There is movement of again potassium, sodium and chloride, therefore it again acts for the osmolarity of the interstitial fluid. Again it increases. So here it was, as the fresh fluid comes, why I have written it as 300, 300 and 400 here? Because whenever a fresh fluid flows, so it is maintained to that of the same. So whenever it flows down, it is maintained to that of the 400. So again and again there will be fresh flow of fluid, so again there will be multiplication. So till the medullary osmolarity is maintained to around 1200 or 2800 or 3000 milliosmolar by this mechanism. So as there is addition or multiplication of the osmolarity here, this mechanism is called counter current multiplier. So the vertical multiplication of the osmolarity could be seen by the addition of solutes. That is why it is called counter current multiplier. So the next is your counter current exchanger. So the counter current exchanger is seen in case of vasorecta. Again, we do have the descending vasorecta and ascending vasorecta, and also it is permeable for the water and the solutes. These are the two which are in a close proximity, and it is deep inside the medulla. So this vasorecta, the blood that is flowing to the vasorecta is having an osmolarity of 300 milliosmoles. It should be, because it is the plasma. So as the blood moves down towards the medulla, it is going through the medullary hyperosmolarity. We have seen the medulla from the cortex to that of the medulla, the osmolarity keeps on increasing. We have seen this increased osmolarity is done by the counter current multiplier system. So in the cortex it is 300, as you go deep down and down and down, it reaches about 1200 to 2800 or 3000 milliosmoles. In the similar fashion, as the blood goes down, it faces the increased osmolarity. So in the descending vasorecta, whenever the blood goes down, the water is lost. The water goes out. But what it gains the solute. It gains the solute. So as the blood is moving to the ascending vasorecta, the water is gained, so it gains the water and it loses the solute out. And it loses the solute out as it passes through the ascending limb. So there is no multiplication, it just maintains the same osmolarity of that medulla, and more importantly, the blood which is 300 milliosmoles when it is in the entry, when it goes out, it is still maintained at the same osmolarity of 300 milliosmoles. So this counter current exchanger prevents the entry of hyperosmolar blood to the veins or to the general circulation. Think, if there was no presence of this anatomical structure, or if there was no counter current exchanger, if this was a straight which leads to the vein, so whenever it is entering, it is 300 milliosmoles. Whenever it goes deep inside, it gets hyperosmolar. So this inside, because it is permeable to the solute and the water, whenever the blood is leaving, it would have been increased osmolarity of the blood. So this is prevented by the anatomical arrangement, such that it only maintains. There is one side, there is loss of water and gain. The other side, there is opposite. There is water gain and solute lost due to this gradient, and it maintains this gradient as such, and it also makes the blood osmolarity to remain the same when it enters to the general circulation. So now we'll discuss the concept of urea recycling. So urea, which is a waste product of nitrogen metabolism, is freely filtered in the glomerulus. it enters inside the PCT. In the PCT, at about 50% of the urea is reabsorbed, and the remaining part goes all over the segment and it is excreted out in the urine. However, it has been proposed that the end part of the collecting duct, the urea can be reabsorbed under the influence of ADH. We have seen in the last class, under the presence of antidiuretic hormone, there is formation of UT1 urea transporters in the cells of the collecting ducts, which helps in the reabsorption of urea. So what is an importance here? Whenever the urea is seen in the interstitium, it again increases the osmolarity of the medullary interstitium. So the urea reabsorption in the last part of the collecting duct adds to the osmolarity of the medulla, and it again increases the osmolarity of the medulla. So this urea can again enter through the descending limb, and it can again go to the next segment. So this is called urea recycling. That is, whatever the urea that is present in the interstitial fluid, it can enter through the descending limb, and it again passes through the distal convoluted tubule, and it goes to the collecting duct, and if it is needed, it can reabsorb or it is excreted in the urine. So this process is referred to be as urea recycling. So here you should remember, urea is the one which can add for the osmolarity of the medulla. So it increases the medullary osmolarity to highest, for example, 2800 or 3000, it is added upon by the urea, and this urea is recycled via passing through the descending limb, and it will be excreted out. So here we discuss what is the role of antidiuretic hormone in concentration or diluting the urine or in maintenance of the plasma osmolarity. So you know, ADH is an hormone that is synthesized in the supraoptic nucleus. It is stored in the posterior pituitary, and this ADH will act on V2 receptors of principal cells. You have seen it in the last class. So the principal cells are the specialized cells that are seen in the late part of the distal convoluted tubule and in the collecting ducts. So whenever they act on V2 receptor, this will create a very important water channel, which is called aquaporin 2. So this aquaporin 2 helps in the reabsorption of water. So water is reabsorbed from the later part of distal convoluted tubule. So again, to put it here, ADH will act and it helps in the reabsorption of the water to the interstitium. In the presence of ADH and aquaporin 2. So whenever the water is reabsorbed, where does this water move? It moves to the blood and it increases the volume, plasma volume. But what happens to the tubular fluid? It gets concentrated. So what happens to the urine? It decreases the urine output. Decreased urine output, or the decreased fluid, it is concentrated urine that is passed. So ADH means antidiuretic hormone. It prevents the water loss in the hormone. How the water loss is prevented in the urine? It is by the reabsorption of water. How the water is reabsorbed? It is through the aquaporin 2. So whenever, for example, you have seen in the body fluid, whenever the plasma osmolarity also increases, there is ADH thirst system that comes into existence. The increase in the plasma osmolarity is detected by the chemo-osmoreceptors, and it really helps in the release of the ADH, which acts on the principal cells in the collecting duct. It helps in the reabsorption of water, and it helps in the maintenance of the volume, and also it compensates the plasma osmolarity. For example, when the volume decreases, it similarly it gives the water and it helps in the increase the volume of the plasma. The ADH, not only this, we have also already seen the ADH also helps in the creation of urea transporters 1, and it helps in the reabsorption of urea. So what is the importance there? It concentrates the interstitium and it increases the medullary osmotic gradient. So the point to be remembered, the regulation of the volume and the osmolarity of the plasma is maintained by the kidney. How it is maintained? It is maintained by counter current mechanism. Number 2, urea cycling. Number 3, by the action of ADH. So if the water has to be reabsorbed so as to maintain the volume and the osmolarity, there should be an increased medullary gradient, which is maintained by the counter current mechanism. The counter current multiplier occurs in the loop of Henle, which will create this increased medullary osmolarity, and it is maintained by the counter current exchanger.